have a wonderful dialogue set in place for you, and it promises to be quite exhilarating and intellectually stimulating. My job this evening as moderator is quite simple. I'll be allowing the participants to make their statements, and it's my job to help you forget me. So I'm going to try to stay out of the way. But we do have a special gift for both of the participants this evening. They both come from New York, as I understand it, and so we want to present something.
Take this further. He is the most influential Jew who has ever lived in the world. Not only is he one of us, he is the number one most influential Jew who has impacted world history. In fact, we use dates around the world based on the approximate time of his birth. But he's not just a general influence. He has brought more people through him, more people, I'm speaking of Gentiles, by the hundreds of millions have come to know the God of Israel through him than through any Gentile, through any Jew. More than Moses, more than any Jew or Israelite that's walked the earth, through Jesus Yeshua, more Gentiles have come to know the God of Israel. I have literally preached and spoken around the world, and it has been mind-boggling to me, from India to Africa to Asian nations and European nations, to run into Christians who will say, I was living a certain way, I was separated from God, I had no knowledge of God, I grew up in this faith or this religion, or I was just a very worldly, ungodly person, and through Jesus I have come to know the God of Israel, and I love and pray for the Jewish people. That is because that is the work of the Jewish Messiah, not just to be for the Jewish people, but to bring the knowledge of God to the ends of the earth. More than any other Jew who has ever lived, point of fact, Jesus has brought the knowledge of God to the nations of the earth. Let me go further than that and say that even today, there are at least 100,000 Jews around the world, possibly a lot more than that, that follow him as Messiah. It may not be that widely reported, and many times Jews who come to faith in Jesus are excluded from the Jewish community by their fellow Jews for various reasons. But in point of fact, in the land of Israel, there are sovereigns following Jesus as Messiah. There are formerly Orthodox and Hasidic Jews today who are following Jesus as Messiah. More than 100,000 Jews around the world. I'm simply saying that faith in Jesus is not just for Gentiles. Faith in Jesus, the Jewish Messiah, is for Jews, and it has been embraced by Jews every generation. Christians talk about the incarnation. It's a theological word, term about God coming in our midst through his Son, dwelling and living among us. And many Jews think, oh, what a repulsive doctrine, what a terrible teaching. But I want you to understand this. It is through Jesus the Messiah that God makes himself known. It's a question in Judaism. It's a question in the Hebrew Bible. How does a God who's infinite, who's eternal, who's inaccessible, who's untouchable by humanity, how can we touch him? How can he be made known? It is through Jesus the Messiah that God comes in our midst and makes himself known. And there are many mysteries in the Hebrew Bible that open up very simply the moment you understand God reveals himself to us through Jesus. Let me go further. He was a true prophet. I was reading an internet article by an Orthodox rabbi that explained that Jesus could not be the Messiah because he was not a prophet. Not only was he a prophet, he was the last and greatest of the prophets on a national level. He predicted the destruction of Jerusalem. He predicted the destruction of the temple. He said that the city of Jerusalem would be overrun by Gentiles for long periods of time. It happened just like he said. And in point of fact, the temple is still destroyed to this very day. He was the one that prophesied and spoken and wept over our city and said, if you could only know what I was here to do and how I came to bless. He wept that his people rejected him. And he said, terrible destruction would come, just like it happened throughout our history in the Hebrew Bible when we rejected the voice of the prophets. He said it would happen, and it happened. He was a true prophet. The most influential Jew who ever lived. The Jew through whom more people have come to know the God of Israel than any other Jew, any other human being. A true prophet. Let me go further. He came when the prophets of Israel said Messiah had to come. There was clear anticipation of a key arrival, of a divine visitation during the days of the Second Temple. The Second Temple was destroyed over 1930 years ago, and yet several different prophets, Malachi and Haggai and Daniel, spoke either of a divine visitation at that temple or of eternal forgiveness coming to the people before that temple was destroyed. We're not talking about arbitrary things, when it might happen, when it might not happen. We're talking about something that had to happen at a certain time. Bear in mind that no other messianic candidate can ever fulfill the prophecies, because some of them said Messiah had to come almost 2,000 years ago. That means that anyone that claims to be Messiah after that is already disqualified, because he had to come and visit that temple in divine glory before it was destroyed. He did it. You see, we've got this thing completely mixed up, completely wrong. I've heard many sincere Jews say to me, some of them good friends of mine, listen, this whole second coming that you teach is just a cop-out. You say Jesus came the first time, and you see he failed in his mission, so now you come up with this cop-out idea that he's going to come again, and you put off all the real prophecies to the second coming. Absolutely wrong. The exact opposite is true. He had to come at a certain point in time and do certain things to guarantee that the future would actually occur the way it was prophesied. He came and did those things. In other words, he came and gave us the deposit and the down payment when it had to come. The ones who are still waiting in vain are my dear Jewish friends who are still expecting him to come when he was supposed to come and make the deposit, the down payment, and shed his blood for our sins almost 2,000 years ago. I have confidence because he came when the prophet said he would come, and because he died according to the scriptures and rose from the dead according to the scriptures, and the knowledge of God continues to spread around the entire world through him. The work is continuing day by day, week by week, month by month, year by year. It is happening and going forward. Therefore, I have confidence that the rest will happen. You know that your beloved Red Sox are going to the World Series because they won the league championship. They did the first part, now the second part. Well, certain things had to be accomplished at one time in history. Messiah came and did it. Now we know the only one that has the credentials to do the rest, and the only potential one to do the rest, namely one other Jew that is potentially the Messiah that was born and died and rose from the dead more than 2,000 years ago. There's none, and there are none that are possible. Let me take this further. There are key prophetic scriptures that he fulfilled that are beyond human control. You cannot plan out resurrection from the dead. You cannot plan out having the nations of the world come to God through you. You cannot plan out that when people call on your name 1,000 years later, you answer. And yet he did these things. Let me take this further and speak on a more personal level to you. If you study Torah, you'll see a massive amount of scripture has to do with atonement, has to do with blood, has to do with priests going and interceding on behalf of the people, has to do with the uncleanness inside the people. Some of the sacrifices were for unintentional sins. Others are clearly taught in the Torah were for intentional sins. And on the Day of Atonement, they covered all of them, intentional, unintentional. What happens now when there's no temple? What happens when it's impossible? For the majority of Jewish history, it has been impossible to obey what is written in the literal Torah, to follow it. Either God has just left us under judgment, the temple being destroyed is an ongoing sign of judgment. Either he has just left us under judgment, or he has provided the fulfillment of what the scripture spoke. His death and resurrection brings to fulfillment everything the Torah was longing for. Take him out of the picture, you're left without atonement. Take him out of the picture, and repentance is only half the picture because you don't have atonement. And when I read the history of our people, I don't have a lot of hope. When I read the history of the human race, I'm not betting on Jew or Gentile to get the job done. I'm trusting in the mercy of God. Because we continually fall short. We continually come under judgment. We continually mess up. You and I need a Savior now. We don't just need a Messiah to come one day in the future. We need a Savior now. We need forgiveness of sins now. We need to get right with God now. We need to be changed and transformed now. Jesus, the Jewish Messiah, is the present tense answer. When you read the Hebrew Bible, you see there's a priestly Messiah. And you see that there is a royal Messiah. What's the answer? The people of the Dead Sea Scrolls were waiting for a priestly and royal Messiah. Many Jewish people 2,000 years ago spoke of a priestly and royal Messiah. What happened to the priestly Messiah and the rest of the Jewish tradition? He's not there. You don't find him. Why? Because Jesus came and fulfilled that role. You say, why did he have to die? Why the sacrifice? Why the suffering? It was to fulfill the role of the priestly Messiah laid out in the Hebrew Scriptures. Through that, you and I have access to God, access to a transformed life. Let me just ask you a couple of questions as I made these opening comments. As a Jewish person, are you absolutely 100% sure that when Messiah comes and reveals himself, it will not be Jesus, it will not be Yeshua? I am sure by the scriptures, because he fulfilled the first part, that he'll fulfill the second part. What hope do you have? What guarantee do you have? I also ask you, if you simply judge yourself based on the Ten Commandments, if God judged your life simply based on the Ten Commandments, would you stand or fall? Everyone here would ultimately fall. What are you doing for forgiveness? What are you doing for atonement? Repentance and atonement go hand in hand in the Bible. You do not have the one without the other. And I just want to say, on a personal level, this is not to convince you, but just on a personal level, for this Jew, it was not the Christian religion that was my salvation and transformation. When I was shooting heroin and using every other kind of drug and living a foul, rebellious life 33 years ago, it was not through traditional Judaism either that my life was transformed. It was through a living faith in a living Messiah, Jesus, Yeshua, who picked me up out of the gutter and turned my life around. For this Jew, he's the difference between life and death. For countless hundreds of thousands of Jews in our history, he's the difference between life and death. When the church went away from its Jewish roots, when the church went away from its scriptures and persecuted and hated the Jewish people, when it comes back to its Jewish roots, embraces the scriptures, and has great love for Israel and the Jewish people. Why? Because we follow and embrace the Jewish Messiah. So I urge you, listen carefully to see if the points that I'm making are actually clearly answered by my dear friend Shmuley. And beware of any type of emotional ploy or appeal by either of us ultimately. Hear us out, think it through, and ask yourself, are you sure? Thank you.
why Christianity is utterly incompatible with Jewishness. Number one, ladies and gentlemen, for the Jewish people, the belief that God can be human is the ultimate heresy. God says clearly in Deuteronomy 4:15, you saw no form of any kind the day the Lord spoke to you at Horeb, Mount Sinai, out of the fire. Therefore, watch yourself carefully so that you not become corrupt and make for yourself an idol. What's an idol? An image of any shape, whether formed like a man or a woman. Central to our belief system is that God is the God of all humanity, men and women alike. He is not a man. If he were a man, then men would be more godly than women. If he were a Jew, then Jews would be more special than non-Jews, which is a lie. We are the chosen nation to bring the knowledge of God to all nations. We are not spiritually superior. God was not a male Jew who roamed around Galilee. The prophet Samuel declares explicitly, he who is the glory of Israel does not lie or change his mind, for he is not a man that he should change his mind. Dr. Michael Brown writes in his own book, page 16, Answering Jewish Objections to Jesus. Quote, now when I read something like that, he's speaking about people who believe that Sai Baba is God in India. When I read something like that, people believe that a man is God. I say, quote, that's absurd. Some man living in India is not God. And when I see that it was presumably a Jew who led the delegation to worship Sai Baba, I feel even more grieved. How can a Jew believe such a thing? And Christians will say, forgive me, I have to run a bit here because there are significant time constraints. Christians will say that the virgin birth foretold that God would be human. Of course, that's in Matthew chapter 1, verse 20. And it's based on a verse in Isaiah 7:14. Therefore, Isaiah says to the prophet Ahaz, who was going to war and asked for a symbol that he would win the war, Isaiah says, therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign, King Ahaz. Behold, the virgin is with child. You will give birth to a son, and you will call him Emmanuel. The only problem? Every honest Christian scholar will tell you the word Alma does not mean virgin. In fact, if you look in Proverbs, verse 30:18, where it says clearly that an Alma is compared to the way of a snake on a rock, the way of a ship on the high seas, the way of an eagle in the air. What's the common denominator of all these three things, ladies and gentlemen? They all leave no trace. That's why the verse goes on to say, this is the way of an adulterous woman. She eats and wipes her mouth. She commits adultery. And she says, I have done no wrong. If a virgin cheated on her husband, to whom she was betrothed, she could not hide it. She would have lost her virginity. Alma cannot mean virgin in that context. There is no prophecy whatsoever that God would ever be human. And there is every verse to affirm beyond the shadow of a doubt. God never takes corporeal form. It is stated over. And I will give you a few of the verses. This is the chief Jewish heresy, the corollary of which is that God in the Jewish Bible is an absolute and indivisible unity. There is no Trinity. This is emphasized in the verse that Jewish children learn before any other, Shema Yisrael, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad. The hero of Israel, the Lord our God, is absolutely one. There is no division in the Godhead. God did not die on a cross. God was not born of a woman. And God never inseminated a mortal. Mike Brown, in his book, quotes various scriptural verses to prove that Jesus, as God, came to Abraham and to Jacob. Famous story of Abraham after his circumcision standing outside of his tent, and three visitors come to him. Mike Brown says, quote, the awesome and exciting thing about this text is that it explicitly tells us that Abraham and Sarah talked with the Lord, Jesus, that he appeared in human form to them, dusty feet and all, and that he even sat down and ate food. Ladies and gentlemen, I challenge any of you to read the verses and see if you can come up with that interpretation. Adam is sitting, Abraham is sitting in front of the tent. It says, and the Lord appeared to him by the oaks of Mamre. That's why it says it was Jesus. To the Jews, the interpretation is simple. God is visiting Abraham because he's sick. He's just been circumcised. And Abraham teaches the Jewish people, even if you're talking to God, hospitality comes first. Three angelic visitors in the guise of humans come to see him. That's why the verses are always in the plural. My Lord, if I have found favor in your sight, do not pass by your servant.
Let a little water be brought and wash your feet and rest yourselves under the tree. Clearly, it's not Jesus. But I'll tell you something more important. Of course, the story goes on to say that there's three angels, each of which came with one with a mission. One to tell Sarah she would have a child. The other to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah. The third to save Lot. I don't want to complicate this. The point is, it is impossible to interpret as God sitting and eating with Abraham. Absolutely impossible. It's an absurd interpretation, born of desperation, which we see again in another interpretation that Dr. Brown gives. When Jacob is sitting, and by the way, imagine if God comes and visits you in your tent, standing there, the first thing you would think of is, hey, let's have a pastrami sandwich. Let's get real here. The first thing, man, let me go slaughter some sheep, God. We would think that Abraham would react somewhat differently to a visitation by God. Then, Mike Brown says, well, by the way, God is human. Look, Jacob wrestled with an angel. Who is that angel according to Mike Brown? Quote, page 30, it was always the Son whom they saw. Again, it was Jesus. Folks, do you realize the implications of that interpretation? If the man that Jacob is wrestling with is Jesus, God, and Jacob defeats him, that means that Jacob is more powerful than Jesus. The interpretation is dangerous and forced and impossible. Number three, we've said Jews cannot believe that God is human. God is indivisible. Number three, the Jewish people and the Jewish religion believes that works are more important than faith. What you do is what matters, not what you believe. To lead a righteous life. There are 10 commandments, not 10 cardinal beliefs in the Jewish religion. Do not kill, do not steal, do not commit adultery. What you do is what matters to God. Works are all important. The concept of the mitzvah, the idea that you could oppose faith at any deity and suddenly be declared righteous, is anathema to Judaism. And I ask any of you if you truly believe that doctrine. Would you marry a man who said he loves you, although he never shows it? Would you love a parent who said they cherish you, but never demonstrated it? Those would be abusive relationships. Life is about what we do. In fact, Paul's interpretation of the abrogation of the mitzvahs of the law is based on a simple mistranslation. And this is because Paul, who quotes the Bible 160 times in his letters, quotes every single time from the Greek Septuagint. Paul could not read the original Hebrew, and that's why there were so many mistranslations. The mistranslation he uses is from Deuteronomy 21:23. There Moses tells the Jewish people that if someone has to be put to death, you cannot leave his body after being stoned. You put him up on a tree to be an example to the people, then you take the body down. And the reason? Because humans are created in God's image. It's an affront to God to leave the body up. Look at how Paul interprets it. Again, the exact Hebrew is, Kikil masa lakim tolo. It is an affront to God, a curse to God, if you leave the body in God's image on the tree. He interprets it in Galatians 3:13 to mean, cursed is everyone who hangs on a tree. You are cursed if you're dependent on the tree of life, on the Torah. Complete mistranslation gets rid of all idea of works. Suddenly, doing mitzvahs, godly deeds, is unimportant, and just believing in Jesus is everything. Which is why, number five, one of the main differences between Judaism and Christianity, which is why we Jews cannot believe in Jesus, is that the central concept of Christianity is that sin can only be atoned for through blood. And since there's no new temple, you need the blood of the Lamb, Jesus, to die for you. Folks, do you know how unbiblical that concept is? Look at Leviticus. You will see that blood sacrifices only ever atone for unintentional sin, not for intentional sin. If you do something intentionally, you must repent. No sacrifice on earth can help you. I'll prove it. Leviticus chapter 4, verse 1. God spoke to Moses saying, speak to the people of Israel and tell them, when anyone sins unintentionally, and then it goes on to say they have to bring a bull of the herd without blemish. Again, chapter 4, verse 13. If the whole congregation of Israel errs unintentionally. Again, chapter 4, verse 14. When the sin that they have committed becomes known, meaning they didn't know, and then when they discover they've sinned, same thing in 4:27. In fact, God says in Amos, in one of the most famous verses in the entire Bible, because it was made famous by Martin Luther King, God says, I despise your feast days. I hate your sacrifices. You bring me burnt offerings and your meat offerings. I will not accept them. Neither will I regard the peace offerings of your fat beasts. And here's the famous verse of Martin Luther King. But let judgment run down as water, as a righteousness, as a mighty spring. That's what God wants. Justice, righteousness. He says he rejects the idea of right. Here's the proof, the greatest proof of all. The most famous book in the entire Bible about repentance is the book of Jonah. And the book of Jonah ends by saying, and the people of Nineveh, who were very wicked, they believed in God. And when Jonah told them they had to repent, they proclaimed a fast, they put on sackcloth. And God saw their works. Listen to the verse. And God saw their works, not their blood, not their sacrifices. God saw their works, that they turned from their evil way. And God repented of the evil that he had said that he would do unto them. And he did not. Mike Brown agrees with me. He says this himself in his book, page 35. He asks the question, if a Nazi could truly repent before he died, and then God would accept him as righteous. I'm sorry, this is his answer. If a Nazi truly repents before he dies, then God would accept him as righteous. But merely believing without true repentance, Michael Brown says, meaningless. That word, meaningless, page 35. As for the Jews killed by the Nazis, if they died in the right relationship with God, then they would go to heaven. If they died out of favor with him, they would perish. He's saying the Jews who died in the Holocaust and didn't believe in Jesus will perish forever. If they died believing in Jesus, then they will go to heaven. But he says clearly, Nazis who died believing in Jesus, that didn't help them one bit because they were evil. Mike Brown agrees that it's about righteous action. Which time will happen? Okay. He also wrote, if, however, by believing in Jesus, you mean putting his trust in the Lord Jesus to cleanse him from sin and guilt, repudiating his evil deeds with his whole heart and turning to God in true repentance, asking for his mercy and pardon, then he would be forgiven. Clearly, folks, if believing in Jesus doesn't bring you repentance anyway, doesn't bring you atonement anyway, and I suggest you turn back to the Jewish idea of repentance, which is change your ways and become righteous. Thank you.
Thanks, Julie. We've become such good friends actually through this year that it's painful for me to differ with him publicly and to systematically refute his points. Nonetheless, I will deal with that pain in him. I want to first point out that not a single point that I made in my opening presentation was rebutted, and most of them were not touched on. That's okay, because Shmuley wanted to emphasize his points in his opening presentation. But I remind you first, the opening points I made remain strong and still stand. Let me just go through his points one at a time. The idea that Christianity is a great world religion and not for Jews is completely impossible. Because if you read the Christian scriptures, so-called, if you read the New Testament, you will see that Jesus came to fulfill what was written in Moses and the prophets, and that the whole faith was understood as a faith to and for the Jewish people first. If Jesus is not the Messiah for the Jewish people, he's the Messiah for no one. Don't say that, well, he's actually a deceiver, and he's actually misled, he's actually not who he claims to be, and he's not the fulfillment of the scriptures, he's not a true prophet, etc. Yeah, but he's good for the Gentiles. I know you don't mean it insultingly, but either he's the Messiah for Israel or he's the Messiah for no one. Secondly, with all respect to traditional Judaism, and there are traditional Jews here that I know are very sincere, whom I deeply respect. In point of fact, the Jewish people were not just called to follow tradition. We were called to be a priestly nation and a light to the world. Following the traditions of Talmud and rabbinic study, however admirable those traditions may be, do not change the world, do not bring light to the world, do not bring redemption. We have grads from our school, among similar schools around the world, who are actively going out to the ends of the earth and jungles and difficult places and forsaken orphans and people on the streets, literally, in America, and reaching them with the good news of the Messiah, Jesus, and bringing them to God because they understand that Messiah came to be a light to the world. It is the Jewish calling, first and foremost. I live for God because I love him. He's had mercy on me and revealed himself to me, and I love him with all my heart, and I want to please him. I don't do it to avoid hell or to gain heaven. Nonetheless, when you read the Torah, let's not even think about beyond this world. Let's talk about what we see in this world. If you read the Torah, read Leviticus 26. Go home and read it. Read Deuteronomy 28, and you will see verse after verse after verse promising severe judgment, punishment, cursing for disobedience. The idea that Judaism doesn't emphasize sin, it doesn't emphasize punishment as part of it, is completely contrary to the Torah. The idea that the incarnation is heresy. If you believe that God stopped being God in heaven and came down as a human being on earth, that would be heretical, absolutely. And Shmuley was quoting from the second volume of my series on answering Jewish objections to Jesus. I spent about 70,000 words dealing with this. point of fact, there were verses like Exodus 24 that says they saw the God of Israel. There are other verses that speak of people seeing God. How can you see him if he's invisible and eternal? The same way he dwelt among the people of Israel in the tabernacle, and his glory and presence filled the tabernacle. His glory and presence filled his Son on the earth, and he makes himself known to us while remaining God in heaven. You say, that's mysterious. Of course it is. When Shmuley said that God is absolute unity, and then quoted Deuteronomy 6:4 in the Shema, and that God is Echad, the word Echad simply means one. Have you ever read the book of Genesis? There was evening and morning, one day, Echad. Did you read in Genesis 2 that they're man and woman, and they become what? Echad. You ever read about the tabernacle that has many different pieces and you put them all together and they become Echad? Did you ever hear of a month for 30 days and that month is Echad? So to say that God is Echad is to say that he's the one we worship, that we don't worship the other gods of the nations. That's all the text is teaching. In fact, God's unity is complex. And if you read through carefully Genesis, the 18th chapter, you'll see the only possible conclusion is that Yahweh, the Lord himself, with two angels came and visited Abraham. Abraham was overwhelmed by the visit. At first doesn't know what to make of it. Then his wife Sarai actually talks to the Lord back and forth. And then when you come to the end of the chapter, Abraham stays and talks to the Lord. And at the beginning of the next chapter, the two angels go to Sodom. Why? Because it was the Lord in terms of the only possible way to read it, the only thing that makes sense. Let me also say that both works and faith are absolutely essential and important. And the place I got the idea from that repentance is important is the words of Jesus, the words of the Holy Testament. It emphasizes repentance book after book and chapter after chapter. It is repentance and faith that brings salvation, that is the gift of God through Messiah. As for blood sacrifices only being for unintentional sins, read Leviticus 5. Surely read Leviticus 4. Keep reading to Leviticus 5. Get to Leviticus 16. You'll see even further. And lastly, the book of Jonah emphasizes the importance of repentance. That is true. But Israel was the priestly nation making sacrifices and interceding for the other nations. And that joined with repentance brings redemption. It's the same today through the Messiah.
Thank you, Rabbi. Was that really so painful for you? It actually looked like you enjoyed it. Yeah. Indeed, Mike and I are dear friends, and strange that they seem. And this is my brand new book, and I'm giving you one of the first copies, so I'm using our friendship to plug my book. It's called Face Your Fear. You see, ladies and gentlemen, you should never turn to a religion out of fear. But clearly, my dear friend, Mike Brown, this book is due. It will be released in a week. Mike feels very different. Right to the beginning of his book, no comparable work exists. This is the definitive guide to Jews why they should embrace Christianity. And Mike really did phenomenal research. Got to know the Talmud, Midrash, it's a magnum opus. Quite an achievement. Then why is so much of it so dependent on scare tactics and fear? If I quoted all the fear quotations, I'd be here for a month. Here's some of them. What happens if the Jews don't believe in Jesus? Here's the answer. It wouldn't be fair to you if I failed to warn you in advance. There are consequences of breaking God's commandments. The standards are high. If you reject these ordained means of atonement, we are in trouble. Well, what are you appealing to there? As surely as God, another page 29, as surely as God judged our people in the past for our sins, he will judge us in the future for our sins. Like it or not, this is page 31, Israel's history suggests judgment has been the norm. In God's sight, it's not just the Adolf Hitlers of the world who are unrighteous. Rather, by his standards, most human beings are unrighteous. Folks, to compare, whatever little sins you and I do to Adolf Hitler is obscene, and it's wrong, and it's ungodly, and it doesn't give the best face to Christianity. And there's no need to scare people like living daylights in God's eyes, you're like Adolf Hitler. But here's the crux. This is a... How then should we view the state of those Jews and Gentiles who have never heard about the Messiah and Savior? We should see them as people about to get on a plane we know will soon crash. It is remotely possible that one or two passengers will survive. But for the most part, we can assume that just about everyone who gets on board will soon die. Therefore, we should warn them not to get on the plane, urging them to go another way. Folks, if you don't believe in Jesus, you are a dead man or a dead woman. If that's not fear, then what is? And you know how sad this is? You know why it's so sad? Because Jesus was a very religious Jew. He loved Judaism. He famously said in Matthew chapter 5, verse 18, sadly a verse that most Christians today utterly ignore. He says, For truly I tell you, until heaven and earth pass away, not one letter, not one stroke of a letter will pass from the Torah until all is accomplished. Therefore, whoever breaks one of the least of these commandments, even the smallest mitzvah, he teaches others to do the same. People who teach others to give up Judaism and embrace faith alone, what does Jesus say will happen to them? They will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does them and teaches them, whoever gets up and says, keep your Judaism, will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. Thank you, Jesus. Ladies and gentlemen, rather than scaring the living daylights out of people to be Christian, I wish that Christians would re-embrace the inspiring words of Jesus, the Orthodox Jew who fought the Romans, because he hated them for their cruelty to the people he loved. Jesus loved his people. He was a Jew who did not think he was divine. He was a Jew who wanted to save the Jews from the yoke of Rome, and hence he was put to death by Pontius Pilate.
That aside, let me deal with the fear tactic issue. Again, the great appeal of the gospel is that God so loved the world. Most famous verse in the New Testament, God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son. People hear the message of love, they think of Jesus, they think of love, cross, sacrifice, etc. But if I know that there's trouble, I'm going to warn. If someone is drowning, and I come with a helicopter at my own risk and get down on the ladder and say, I'm here to help you, you don't deserve it, you capsized your boat because you were foolish, I'm here to help you, and I extend my hand, you're drowning. What if the person says, who are you to judge me for drowning? That's the most hate-filled thing. I'm trying to help you. This is a message trying to help. So I ask then, and just for talking, because we both agree that this is inspired, what do you do with God saying, if you don't obey the Lord your God, do not carefully follow his commands I'm giving you today, all these curses will come upon you and overtake you. You'll be cursed in the city, cursed in the country. You'll sow much seed in the field, but you'll harvest little. All these curses will come upon you. You'll be smitten with every type of disease. You'll even eat your children in the siege because of judgment. There's even Jewish tradition that says that when God came down on Mount Sinai, that the whole mountain was picked up. This is in your own tradition, Shmuel, was picked up and hovered over the heads of the people. And God said, are you going to obey or not? They said, no, we will obey. The idea of judgment is throughout the prophets. It's not that God is hate-filled or using fear tactics. He's warning us because he sees we're in trouble, that we're a messed up world and a messed up race. And he's saying, if you disobey, because he knows human beings, there are consequences. How do you deny, Shmuley, the clear consequences that are warned in the Torah?
Firstly, on the subject of Paul is very misleading. He says that he was a student of Gamaliel. And he wants to have he's claiming a high honor. He's claiming to have been the student of the greatest Jewish sage of his age. And of course, the New Testament will tell you that he was persecuting the early Christians. Folks, look at the book of Acts, chapter 5, chapter 21. You'll see that it was the Pharisees who continually saved the apostles from persecution by the Sadducees. It was the Sadducees persecuting the early church. Paul was a Sadducee. He was not a Pharisee. That's why he could not read the original Hebrew. That's why he makes so many mistranslations, which is universally recognized by all scholars of the New Testament. He quotes always from the Septuagint. And whenever the two texts diverge, he quotes the Septuagint rather than the Hebrew Bible. And he clearly said, basically a police enforcer. He was sent by the Sadducee and high priest. He says that he was an officer of a high priest. The high priest worked for Rome. The high priest was appointed by Rome, not by Gamaliel. You cannot be a student of Gamaliel and an officer of the high priest at the same time. On the subject of God repeatedly warning the Jews that X will befall them if they abandon his covenant, there's two ways to understand it. One is the way Mike Brown is understanding it. Jews, you better save your skin, because I do business deals, God says. This is a commercial transaction. You obey me, you wash my hand, I take care of you. But if not, I go from being God to being the Godfather, and I'll whack you, okay? I become Tony Soprano. The problem with that understanding is that religion becomes nothing but something self-serving. Why should you serve God to save your own butt? Which is another way of saying worship yourself. I don't believe in that kind of religion. I believe that religion is about worshiping God. And here's how Jews understand those verses. And by the way, folks, it behooves us not, you know, to bring some depth and no superficiality to reading such a divine text. You know, when it says that God outstretched his right arm, I don't think that might mean right there that God, you know, that there was a giant arm in Egypt. It's a figure of expression. And it means clearly, God is saying, when I withdraw my presence from you, which the Jews understand to mean the concept of hester panim, the secret of the divine concealment, all of that stuff happens almost automatically. It's like a husband, it's like a wife saying to her husband, if you cheat on me, it's not that I'm going to go and report you to the IRS, and I'm going to cut off all your suits, and I'm going to shoot you. She's saying, I'm out of here. You have wounded me. And just wait and see what happens to your life once I go. You take me for granted. You think a home is here and a warm meal and children and love and comfort? When it's gone, look what will happen to you. That's what God is saying.
I want to remind you that I did point out Romans 1:16, the most famous divergence where the Septuagint reads one way, and Paul, because of his understanding of Hebrew, rightly quotes the Hebrew text. I'd also draw your attention to a massive commentary on Romans by Joseph Shulam and Hilary McCormick, filled with massive rabbinic references that make it clear you can only understand Paul if you understand the first as a religious Jew. What do we do, Shmuley, with verses like this? If you do not carefully obey all the words of this law, again, Deuteronomy 28, which are written in this book, and do not revere this glorious and awesome name of the Lord your God, the Lord will send fearful plagues on you and on your descendants, harsh and prolonged disasters, and severe and lingering illnesses. He will bring upon you all the diseases of Egypt that you dreaded, and they will cling to you. The Lord will also bring on you every kind of sickness and disaster, not recorded in this book, until you're destroyed. And it goes on, verse 63 of Deuteronomy 28, just as it pleased the Lord to make you prosper and increase in number, so it will please him to ruin and destroy you. You will be uprooted from the land you are entering to possess. In point of fact, we know that obedience is for our good. No one understands that God's ways are ways of life, but he warns us of severe consequences if we get off the path. And he needs to warn us because as human beings, we need warning. In point of fact, the book of Jeremiah, I'm just finishing a commentary on the book of Jeremiah now. It's very painful writing because he spends basically 40 years of ministry warning his people and saying over and again, Shuvu Banim Shalavim, turn back, go back, turn your children. And God offers to heal and redeem and have mercy. He says, if you don't, I'll come and destroy my own temple and scatter you to the nations. And God does that. And he takes responsibility and says, if you'll repent and turn back, I will bring you back to the land. You may paint God a certain way, surely, and take these points and make them into Tony Soprano, but these are sacred words. This is sacred text. And we are warned. There are more warnings than there are promises of blessing. Let's first deal with that. And then we can talk about the justice and the rightness of it. But as long as we stick our heads in the sands and deny it, it's counterproductive.
I assume, Mike, that's why you write, the Holocaust then was a massive, overwhelming example of divine discipline. Devastating for the moment, but leading to health and healing in the end. Do you remember the day after 9/11 when Jerry Falwell and Pat Robertson said that America was being punished for abortion and homosexuality? Do you remember how we all cringe at hearing that Osama bin Laden was an instrument of God to take vengeance against evil, wicked New Yorkers, so sinful that they dared to go and feed their families by going to the law office or their trading floor? We can have this kind of religion if we want, where everything is taken in the most literal possible sense, and we focus entirely on the negative. There's only two places in the Torah where they call the Tova Club, where these curses are enumerated. And the Hasidic masters always were able to read it even backwards and find all kinds of hidden meanings of the greatest blessings, because they understood that even when a father admonishes his children, it's because he loves them. Mike Brown would have us believe that God has a deep-seated hatred for humanity. He sits and he waits for us to sin. That God sits, you can interpret it any way you want, but when I hear that all God cares about is my righteousness and never about me, that God has no intrinsic relationship with me, but that God's desire, I mean, everything is, it's amazing. I'm having to move away from this discussion of sin and punishment, but as I said, it's Mike's whole book. Is that all Jesus has to offer? Is that it, folks? You mean there was no Sermon on the Mount? You mean there was no man curing leper? You mean there was no man helping the poor, the destitute? There was no ministry? You mean Jesus was simply walking around Galilee saying, man, are you gonna get it? That's what Is that parenting? I threaten my kids. I tell them, look, if you do X, you'll be punished. Is that the essence of my parenting? It's drawing a red line in the sand. Don't go there. But everyone knows that when you just give people fear, it doesn't last. That's why there's no Soviet Union today. They scared the living daylights out of Eastern Europe, Belarus, and Poland, and the Czech Republic, and they're gone. America rewarded its citizens with freedom, and that's why we're the strongest, most powerful nation in the world. Let us see a vibrant Christianity not based on Mel Gibson's The Passion, full of blood and gore. Give us something that Jesus said that lifts us up. That should be Christianity, not this ongoing discussion of punishment.
Basically happened is Shmuley has raised a point and inadequately answered my response. He put something on me about fear tactics. I did not get up with fear tactics. Right. Did you hear me get up with fear tactics?
No.
Why don't you read the several thousand pages I've written and see how much the fear tactics is there? Or better yet, read the New Testament yourself. What the fear tactics are Shmuley's fear tactics to get you afraid of my faith. Let me also say,
get used to it. We ain't going that Christian missionaries need to repeatedly use fear tactics is because they can't answer the greatest question of all. Why hasn't Jesus fulfilled any of the Messianic prophecies? They need to use fear because they can't use love. There's no reward. That's the problem. It would take me 20 minutes to read all of the most essential Messianic prophecies. I'm sure that you're aware of many of them. Isaiah 11:6, the wolf shall lie with the lamb, the leopard shall lie down with the kid. The nursing child shall play with the hole of the asp. Psalm 72, in his days, the righteous will flourish. The peace will abound, to the moon be no more. Is there any peace in the world today, folks? He shall have dominion from sea to sea. Jesus was put to death by the Romans. His life did not accord with a single messianic prophecy. That could be proven. And you have very intelligent people like Mike that can twist verses in order to show, well, he fulfilled. There is one where it says that Jesus, that the Messiah, would quote John 12:14, Jesus found a young donkey and sat on it. As it is written, do not be afraid, daughter of Zion. Look, your king is coming, sitting on a donkey's colt. I don't think that sitting on donkeys is necessarily proof that you're the Messiah. But all the other ones, the dead shall live, Isaiah 26:19, Ezekiel 37:21, the Jews will be gathered from every quarter of the globe. And finally, that the earth will be covered with the knowledge of God as the waters cover the ocean floor. Folks, if you believe that the Messiah has come already, then you have to believe that godliness and religion makes no impact on this world. Then Jesus, even if it's Judaism Messiah, he's an utterly failed Messiah. Because our world stinks, as Mike said over and over and over. If that's what the Messiah is, then we better become secular and atheists and just go and cure diseases like cancer and AIDS on our own, because the Messiah is worthless. If the Messiah leads to people having their heads chopped off and Holocausts and Inquisitions, that's why you see we Jews are not interested. Because the Messiah means that the earth shall be filled with the knowledge of God, that the water is covering the ocean full.
Thank you.
Supernaturally blessed. And there'll be different answers in this auditorium as to what the cause of that is. But we have not fulfilled our mission to be a light to the nations. And as a nation, we have not embraced the Messiah. And for the most part, we've not embraced Torah or the prophets. Let me say lastly that the goal is not for Jews to become Christians, but for Jews to be faithful followers of the Jewish Messiah, Jesus.
Jewish survival and how few Jews there are. When one of the reasons there are so few Jews is that Christians killed off so many of them for 2,000 years. We have sustained a 2,000-year Christian assault on Judaism. Christians by far were our worst enemies. They crusaded against us, they pogromed against us, they inquisitioned us, they burned us at the stake. They stole our children and converted them. And in the modern age, it's all changed. Thanks to evangelical Christianity, which I have said many times on the record, I consider it to be the foremost force for good in America today, with one great caveat. They still want the Jewish people to disappear and become Christian. But thanks to evangelical Christians, you have become our greatest friends. You love Israel as much as the Jewish people, and you support it as much as the Jewish people. But to speak about the disappearance of the Jews, how few Jews there are, when it's Christians who peeled us off. I mean, it's just, it's chutzpah. Here's what Mike Brown wrote in his book, page 121. Listen to this. Tell me if this is a rational statement. As for Jewish people being persecuted for rejecting the message of Jesus, no Jew has ever been killed for rejecting the message I am declaring to you. No Jew has ever been put to death for refusing the New Testament message of the love of God. None of our forefathers were put to death as a result of rejecting this good news I'm sharing with you. Folks, that is a desecration of the memory of millions of Jews who were killed at the sword for not being baptized. That is a desecration of their memory. We dare not say such travesties of the truth. It's called a big lie. And if you tell it enough times, people begin to believe it. It's modern-day Christians that are godly. That was 2,000 years of Christianity. It was ungodly. Mike Brown says it himself. Our people have been persecuted, abused, expelled, and even killed for rejecting a counterfeit message of a counterfeit Christ preached by a counterfeit church. This church, or rather this man-made, politically oriented, sometimes corrupt religious institution, became so contaminated that when John was exposed to the sins of his fellow clergymen, he was burned at the stake. It's time to repent of Christian sin. Please stop trying to convert us, and please start respecting us.
I need a question for the rabbi now. Is this a question for the rabbi? Please, go ahead.
Gentlemen, I want to say I'm impressed with your gifts and your abilities. I have not seen this kind of intellectual and spiritual repartee in years, and I want to let you know how much I appreciate your Rabbi, may I ask you humbly, and this is a sincere question. If a Gentile who is a believer that Yeshua is Messiah, if he claims that this man who walked 2,000 years ago is Messiah, and he lives according not to the misnomer and the foolishness that's happened for 2,000 years under the persecution that we face, but if he lives according to the message that Yeshua gave, and if he truly loves the Jew and celebrates it, is it okay for that Gentile, and does God accept that that Gentile should believe that he is Messiah if he's not Messiah? And does God accept to that Gentile person, well, you know, it's okay, he's got an excuse, he's a Gentile. I mean, the question is it okay for him to believe, even if he's not, considering the scripture tells us all things do not, we are to be born of goyim, and if that's the case, do we end up basically defeating ourselves by letting them believe a false lie? Thank you.
I felt the sincerity of that question. Words that emanate from the heart penetrate the heart. I believe that Jesus was the Gentile Messiah. I agree with Mike Brown. Belief in Jesus has brought billions of peoples to God. Greatest Jewish thinker of all time, Maimonides, wrote 850 years ago, and it wasn't exactly an era of mutual religious respect. He wrote that Christianity has done everything Judaism has, which is to bring the knowledge of God to distant shores, distant isles. I want to see Christianity strengthen the United States. I would love to see every Christian embrace their heritage. I am at the forefront of encouraging Christians to go to church. I love being an American, partly because evangelical Christianity is so strong in the United States. I love the evangelical community, but there's that one caveat. As far as it comes to Jews, I've met a lot of Messianic Jews who are very sincere. They want to keep all the mitzvahs and they want to believe in Jesus. And let me also state on the record that a Messianic Jew, remember what you believe, you are my brother, you are a Jew that will never change. And I don't want to see Jews for Jesus, any other group treated badly by the Jewish community. I want them debated and I want them refuted. But they are our brothers, and we must treat them with respect. Garrett Smith, who hosted me the entire day, couldn't have been more of a gentleman, and I'm grateful to you. But they have still cut themselves off from the ancient faith of the Jewish people. For all the reasons that I have said, they have absolutely cut themselves off. Because we Jews connect with God without any intermediary. We connect with God not through faith, but through works, through mitzvahs. We believe that the end does not justify the means. We believe that action is more important than intention. And finally, we believe that the Jewish people must continue to be a light unto the nations. We dare not disappear by converting to any other faith.
Comment?
Surely. Consistently that the Jewish people need to reclaim Jesus as an authentic Jewish teacher, according to Shmuley, even a Pharisaical rabbi, and yet he's the Messiah of the Gentiles. See, when you read what he said, the whole New Testament says the same thing. We found him through Moses and the prophets wrote. This is the one. If he is not the one prophesied of in Scripture, then he was self-deceived, and all of his followers were deceived. And Jews should go into the whole world and say, do not believe in this lie, rather than say, Christianity is a great world religion. You can believe in a self-deceived and deceiving one who misled masses of people into thinking he was the Messiah when he really wasn't. That's okay, because you're Gentiles. No, truth is truth for all people. And let me also emphasize that Judaism strongly emphasizes faith along with works. I mentioned Maimonides. Of course, you pray these daily, these 13 principles, and every day, I believe with a perfect faith, point after point, faith and works go hand in hand. With the right emphasis, first you have to know him and believe in him to follow him and obey him.
They did not kill Zechariah ben Berechiah. Why should Jews accept a gospel that does not quote the scripture directly, accurately? Number two, why in the world are Pharisaic rabbis living 2,000 years ago guilty of killing Abel and of all the righteous people who have preceded him?
Great. Thank you so much for the question. You mentioned Matthew 25. I think you're referring to Matthew 23:35. I'll do the same thing sometimes and don't get it exactly right. So Matthew 23, you meant 35. So upon you will come all the righteous blood that has been shed on earth, from the blood of righteous Abel to the blood of the Zechariah, son of Berechiah, whom you murdered between the temple and the altar. Firstly, he doesn't say that they killed Abel. These people said, if we lived in the days of our forefathers, we would not have killed the prophets. And yet, when the prophet came among them, they were among those who wanted him dead. So all he's saying is, just like the prophet Jeremiah and others, you're committing the same sins your fathers had. You persecuted the prophets, your fathers persecuted the prophets. Zechariah, the first chapter, actually talks about that. As to the second question, is he accurately quoting scripture? Scholars have several different responses to this. If you study the Hebrew scripture carefully, you know that there are many errors in the current manuscripts that we have. And even when the Masoretes, many different manuscripts with minor variations, and Dead Sea Scrolls discovered certain things that confirmed errors in text. And the Talmud, there's one famous citation of the Talmud that
that I deal with in my paper, and Equal Weights and Measures, that quotes a verse non-existent in the Tanakh. So textual scholars wrestle with this. Some believe that it was a scribal error, that the original text referred to the very same man who spoke of. Others simply say that there was a Yechaiah, that this very Zacharias and Berechiah was killed, and we know from the scriptures and Talmudic tradition that other prophets were martyred as well. So it's possible that he was martyred, and it's not recorded in the Hebrew text, just like Isaiah's martyrdom that the Talmud speaks of is not recorded in the Hebrew text. In addition to that, if you'll study the targum to Lamentations, targum to Echa, it actually conflates these two deaths. It does the exact same things in the New Testament. That's part of your traditional Jewish literature. So there are several different lines of response. It's a very healthy question, though, and I appreciate you asking.
Well, you're only touching on one major discrepancy. And I'm not here to make Jesus look illiterate. I believe that Jesus was actually extremely devout and knowledgeable Pharisaic rabbi. That's why all of his, so many of his teachings come straight from Jewish sources. Really, his teachings were a restatement of classical Judaism. And that's why he said, anyone who doesn't keep the Torah will be the least in the kingdom of heaven. But because we're on verses, let's just go through a few of them. You know, Mike was saying that Paul could read Hebrew, and he did not quote from the Septuagint. Famous example given by scholars proving that he could not is from 1 Corinthians 15:55, where Paul writes, "O death, where is thy victory? O death, where is thy sting?" He's quoting from Hosea 13:14. The actual Hebrew reads, "O for your plagues, O death, O for your sting, O grave." Totally different verse. It's just that in the Septuagint, that's Paul's quote comes directly from there. But you don't have to go to the whole question of the high priest. There's more fundamental errors in the New Testament that unfortunately make Jesus look bad. I don't want to look bad, because as I said, I believe he was a very knowledgeable Pharisaic rabbi. The most conspicuous is, and this is unbelievable, is that in Matthew 22:37, and then again in Mark 12:30, Jesus misquotes the Shema. The Shema is the most fundamental Jewish prayer known by kids at age of 3. Of course, it's, "Here is the Lord your God." I'm sorry, it's the Lord your God. See, Imam is quoting. Jesus says, "You should love the Lord your God with all your heart, your soul, and your mind." He says it again in Mark, "all your mind." Now, clearly, no Jew, even secular Jews, I don't think would misquote the Shema. The explanation behind this is that the New Testament was written well after the Jewish wars against Rome, and that's why there's so much anti-Semitism in it. They were trying to distance Jesus from his people. They were trying to show that Jesus hated these people. That's why the book of John is the most anti-Semitic of all, where Jesus is saying, "You are children of the devil, you have no relationship with God." But none of that is accurate. Jesus loved his people and died when the Romans killed him, when he was fighting their battles to end Roman cruelty.
Well, we're fast approaching the time when we need to wrap our session up. It would be lots of fun to go on and on. This kind of exchange is really exhilarating. But we need to be very careful because Rabbi needs to catch a flight later on. So what we'll need to do is, at this point in time, we need to move toward final remarks. Dr. Brown and the rabbi will have 2 minutes each. And then after their final remarks, I'll make a couple of closing remarks for our evening. So, Dr. Brown.
First, again, thank all of you for coming. And I really do thank my dear friend Shmuley for having the courage and forthrightness to come in a setting like this and to share these things openly. And I do appreciate that. And honestly, I had to convince myself mentally and psychologically to be every bit as aggressive as I was before we were friends. So hopefully I succeed. So let me say this to all of you. Again, my goal was to speak to Jewish people and those that will see this video or listen to a tape later. My goal was to urge each of you, if you do not believe in Jesus Yeshua, to reconsider, to ask yourself, why are you so sure that you're right in your position? So I remind you that certain messianic prophecies had to be fulfilled before the Second Temple was destroyed. Jesus Yeshua alone came and did that. No other true messianic candidate can arise since then or has arisen in the last 2,000 years. So he fulfilled the essential prophecies that had a definite time frame, had to be completed before the Second Temple was destroyed. Therefore, we have assurance he will fulfill the rest. Not only that, he identifies with us in our suffering. I said quite plainly that no Jew has ever been killed for refusing the message of the love of God and the authentic message of Jesus through authentic followers of him. Those who killed Jews or anybody in Jesus' name were hypocrites, and nothing less and nothing better than hypocrites who did something. Think of this. I felt
throne and belches out commands. Somebody who knows what it is to be rejected and misunderstood and his name hated and reviled around the world by Jewish people. He identifies with us in our suffering. He is our ideal Messiah. Every day thousands of people around the world are coming to the God of Israel through him. And I get emails on a regular basis. This Orthodox Jew here, this Hasidic Jew, this Israeli teenager, this lost one here, coming to vibrant, wonderful faith in Jesus the Messiah. I urge you, I encourage you, study your scriptures. And Messiah is not only dead, but risen from the dead. Ask God if he is really the one to make it known to you, and you will have the transforming experience of your life. Thank you.